Again, if you're our guest this morning, my name is Ryan, and I'm the lead pastor. I'm so glad you're here today. It's a unique Sunday for us, and that you're in for a treat. I'm not speaking, so that's great, which means it'll make sense. We have a meaning, a quality to it that you're not used to, so it might be difficult for you to experience something good, but that's all right. So we're excited. This week has been fun for us. It's kind of we're kind of halfway through our kind of year of raising funds and supporting our global missionaries, and many of us in the room are global outreach giving partners who support our global outreach ministry partners that are all around the world, and beginning locally right here in Sanford, stretching into other parts of New England, into the United States, all the way around the world, that are loving people, loving God, serving the poor. And so it's been a good week. We had our auction for Africa, which is an annual event where we raise money for some great ministries that are doing incredible work in Africa that are part of our kind of global outreach strategy. And so many of you were there last night. If you were there last night, just give me like a woo woo or something. I don't care. Yeah. All right. Good. So that's many of you. I'm here this morning. I'm iced up, limber. So if you weren't here, you have no idea what that means. You just think it's weird, but such is knowing me. So we had a great night last night, lots of fun, and we raised well over $25,000 last night for some great ministries. So thank you to everybody who came out. Thank you to all the sponsors. Thank you to everybody who gave so generously and paid way too much for items that they knew weren't worth it at all. So, but it was a lot of fun, and we appreciate everybody participating in that. And so today we're actually in our series Beyond Trending, and we started this series 2 weeks ago. And we said Jesus came and modeled what God has established for his people thousands and thousands of years ago, that his people be a nation, a group of people that did what? Justice, love mercy, walk humbly, and made disciples. And Jesus modeled that for all of us. And so we have this great opportunity this series to learn, what does it mean to do that in our normal lives? What does that mean to live this call, to go beyond the trends, to live a life that lasts, that doesn't get caught up in the day-to-day, you know, kind of things that are great, that are go viral, but how do we actually live a sustained life that has a long impact? And so I'm excited today to have with us from Ethiopia, Abraham Fiseha. And Abraham runs a ministry called Youth Impact, and he'll tell you a little bit more about that as he shares with us. But this is a ministry that's focused on doing those things: justice, loving mercy, walking humbly, and making disciples. It's not just enough for us to go and serve the poor, to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, but if we don't bring the life-changing truth of what a relationship with Jesus Christ brings, it just continues a cycle generation after generation. But what changes that is when people come to an understanding of who Jesus is and how Jesus loves them and equips them for a much better way of living. And before he comes, we're going to show you this amazing video that was made on behalf of Youth Impact. This is what Youth Impact is. When the video's over with, give Abraham a great big hand. I want to encourage you to lean in today. Listen to what Abraham has to say. What he has to say is very powerful. If you can get past it, it's a little different than what you might be used to. Just lean in. But check out this video. Welcome Abraham after it.
Life holds both beauty and brokenness. Life in Ethiopia is no different. Ethiopia is a nation with an ancient history. It's a nation with unmatched natural resources of gems and minerals, gold and silver. Yet, it's also a nation with a history of war and famine. Of all Ethiopia's 96.6 million residents, the median age is only 18. 42% of the population is under the age of 14. That's almost half. That's over 40 million children. This is a nation of youth, of energy, beautiful young people with beautiful dreams. Yet, this is also a nation with few parents, a nation with fewer grandparents. That today's buds of beauty must be tended if tomorrow's blossoms are to bloom. We saw the brokenness and the beauty in the parentless and had to respond. We started with the hopes of our own future in mind. We need leaders. leaders who will determine the destiny of this nation. In order to develop leaders with character, we have to start with the basics. We pull kids off the street, give them shelter, feed them, educate them, give them skills. We help them find their unique gifts, joys, and potential, based on the teachings of Jesus Christ. Over 100 young people have gone through our youth mentoring program. Most of our kids grow up to become productive adults. Some graduate from vocational skills training programs. They are skilled laborers and full-time workers with a deep sense of purpose. They are construction workers, leather workers, machine operators, teachers. These children have found their purpose in Christ. Those kids that used to wander the streets, barely surviving, are now thriving. They are Ethiopia's destiny, full of life and full of hope. Help us make an impact.
If you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Matthew 25. Verses 34 and 40. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance and the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you stranger and invited you in, or needing clothes, and we clothed you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The king will say, "I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it for me." I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and also bring you greetings from my colleagues who are serving God with me in Ethiopia. I thank you for inviting me to come to Kurtz Lake and for giving me the opportunity to share with you the transformation taking place among the needy of our country. Over the last couple of years, several of you have come to Ethiopia to visit us. It's a miracle to see how God has knitted our hearts together in such a short time. I must admit, this relationship was meant to become, and God has bigger plans and purpose for this relationship. Thank you, too, for making us beneficiaries of the auction for Africa that was held last night. Before I go in any further, allow me to say a few words about my journey as a Christian, as it is a story of God's grace and mercy in my life. I was born in a small, dusty little town in northern Ethiopia. When I was an infant, my mother passed away. My father, who would have been in his 20s at the time, left town to a bigger city, leaving me with my grandmother. So I grew up with a loving grandmother and not knowing my real father and mother. At the age of 14, I met my father for the first time and moved to the city he was living and started a new life. Fortunately, when I met my father, he had already accepted the Lord, and because of his faith and desire For me to know God, he decided to enroll me in a Christian school where the Bible was taught as a subject. This became the first turning point in my life. The school I went to had a logo which read, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge," from Proverbs 1:7. So we can see it as we walk in and out of the school ground, which reminded us of God and knowledge. Although at the time we did not take the biblical teachings given to us seriously, but slowly the word of God started to sink in, and soon after I reached high school, I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. But not too long after that, life in Ethiopia took another turn. The government, the king at that time, the ruler of the country who ruled over 50 years, was overthrown by a ruthless communist regime. Fear and terror gripped the nation, and many people started to die, and many others fled the country. Churches became persecuted. War, famine, torture, and mass killings became daily occurrences. But the Lord had another plan for my life, and he saved me by bringing me to this beautiful country of yours at such an early age. And I started to go to college in the Midwest of America. The reason why I'm standing in front of you here today is because God's people like you had shown me the love of Jesus at such an early age and invested in me their love and shared their resources with me generously. You will be happy to know that many of these people who have mentored and poured their love in me come from this country of yours. Some have gone to be with the Lord since then, but their memory and love is still fresh in my heart. I'm sure if I ask you what you know about Ethiopia today, the thing that may come to your mind, perhaps if you're above the age of 40, will be the images of famine and faces of hungry people, as that was repeatedly shown on your TV during the famine of the 80s. To some of you, it may be the story of the Ethiopian eunuch found in your Bible in Acts in chapter 8, where the Ethiopian eunuch traveled all the way to Jerusalem to worship God as it was customary at the time. And on his way back, traveling on the desert road to Gaza, he was sitting in his chariot reading words from the book of Isaiah about Jesus. That chapter reads like this: "He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer, he is silent, so he did not open his mouth. His humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth." Then the Spirit tells Philip the prophet to go to the chariot to meet with the man and help him understand the words. The Holy Spirit touches the man, and he gets baptized by Philip and continues with his trip to Ethiopia. Beautiful early story of how the gospel moved to Africa. But if you love coffee like me, you should thank Ethiopia, because it's the birthplace of coffee. In fact, I would like to use the commercial that Chick-fil-A uses. Instead of having beef, you know, the cow says, "Have more chicken." Have more coffee is what I would like to say, because it's good for Ethiopia. Like heard the story about the Ethiopian eunuch, Ethiopia is also blessed with many old, ancient, cultural, and many historical heritages. but it's also a place where many tragic events of the past has happened. Even as I speak to you this morning, there are over 10 million people affected by drought, by the current drought caused by El Nino. And over 100,000 homeless people live on the streets of Addis Ababa, the city where I come from. And over half of this 100,000 people are young children that live on the streets. Some are destitute orphans. Others are poor kids who flocked into the city in search of a better life and have lost direction. Too often, they live under tremendous danger, rejection, and alienation. They normally live by scavenging leftover foods from restaurants, and whenever they can, they beg for money from passerbys. Exposed to hunger, these young people often suffer from disease. They are helpless, and their future is bleak. They need someone to help them navigate through life and their place in this world. These are the people God has called us to minister to. These are the children of God. They need love, they need care, but most of all, they need someone to guide them find a lasting peace in their Heavenly Father. When I think of my own country and the world at large, I'm reminded of the words of the prophet Habakkuk. The story took place in Judah around the 640 BC during the reign of King Josiah. Interestingly enough, Josiah was a good king, God-fearing king, but the people he was ruling were not. They were culturally very religious, following the laws, but their heart was far from God and their deeds were evil. And God was displeased with them. There was deep-rooted injustice, evil in the society. Dismayed by the injustice and violence around him, Habakkuk, the prophet, starts to question God why he would tolerate such evil and injustice of the people. The prophet started to ask God for an answer with these words: "How long, O Lord, must we call for help, but you do not listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrong? Destruction, violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted." Like the time during Habakkuk, we also must ask ourselves when we see what's happening around us. Habakkuk was overwhelmed by what was going on in his nation, and he couldn't understand why God would tolerate such evil. He wants God to act with justice and mercy. But to his surprise, God's reply to him was, "More disaster is on the way." God says to Habakkuk, "Look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed. I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told. I'm raising up Babylonians, much worse, that ruthless, impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places not their own." Habakkuk could not understand why God would use such wicked people to punish his people, and pleads to God again and says, Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? After having gone through all the questions with God, finally Habakkuk finally accepts God's sovereignty and surrenders to his will and says, Lord, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds. O Lord, renew them in our day, in our time. Make them known and make them known in wrath. Remember mercy. This should be our prayer as well. In wrath, God, remember mercy. When we read the words of Habakkuk, we can tolerate, we can relate to them. The good news is, like the prophets, we too can also cry to the Lord for mercy and plea for redemption and restoration. We can fully trust our God who revives and redeems his people. God moves through history, redeeming, hearing cries of his people. In 2 Corinthians 7:10, Paul tells the Corinthians, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death. And in 2 Chronicles 7:14-15, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. I don't know about you, but lots of times I get concerned about the world our children are growing these days. Violence and lawlessness seems to dominate the daily news. We live in a world of cynicism and apathy that perpetuates hate and animosity among people. Respect for human life is becoming absent. In all this, it's the young and the innocent that suffer the most as they are growing under increasingly cruel world. How is it possible a young man or a woman would blow up to shreds to kill as many innocent people as the recent tragic scenes we've seen in Europe? But although as humans it is natural that we tend to worry and despair, and we see tensions growing around the world or face threats of war and radicalism and wars and refugee and crisis. But our Heavenly Father is always there to help us if we turn to Him for help. Even if our situation does not change, our Lord still extends revival and redemption. Habakkuk understood this when he finally turned to his God and said, though the fig tree does not bud, there are no grapes on the vines. Though the olive fails and fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in my God, my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength, and He makes my feet like a feet of the deer. He enables me to go on the heights. Despite the bleak-looking world we live in, God's intention for us is to be at peace with our Heavenly Father and do what pleases Him. His will for us Christians is to be the salt and the light in a hateful world. It is under such circumstances that the Lord requires of us to care for the poor, the orphans, the widows. It is under such world that God requires of us to act justly, to love mercy, and walk humbly before Him. It is under such world that He wants us to proclaim the good news to the poor, heal the broken heart, free the captives, give sight to the blind, and free the oppressed. It is under this circumstance that God wants us to live a life worthy of His kingdom. Is it easy? The answer is no, it's not. But it's a call for us here today, and what a privilege it is to be part of God's plan in a hurting world. It is about looking for what is wrong around us and work towards making it right, like Pastor Ryan said last week. In Galatians 6, the Bible tells us, a man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. 14 years ago, a group of us got together to pray for our nation and discuss what we can do to help our people, especially the youth. Two of us had previously lived in the USA and other countries working with Christian organizations and had come back to our broken home country to help and be part of the healing process after communism fell in 1991. After long consideration and prayer, we found the answer in the teachings of Jesus and drafted a vision for our ministry to reach as many young, needy youth of our nation with the love of God and enable them to become God-fearing, productive, fulfilled citizens with values that can inherit the future of the nation. We started to meet with the young people, sharing the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. We studied godly values from the Bible, like Sermon on the Mount, and those of us older shared our life experiences. We lived and ate together. We prayed and cried together. We sang and worshiped our Lord together. God moved, and we started to see results, like the ones you saw. Today, we operate 3 homes around the city, mentoring young people, reaching them with the Word of God, feed them, help them with their school and many other needs they may have. We try to help them find God and fall in love with Jesus so that they can find new sight and new vision and purpose for their life. We want them to know that God can bring forth healing and transformation in their life, strengthen their hearts, enlighten their minds, and give them greater worth and capacity to love and to trust. It is about giving a new life, new creation in Christ. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. When our young people come to us and go through that process, they become new creation in Christ. In Matthew 22, the Pharisees got together and asked Jesus this question: "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it: love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on to this command, to these two commandments." May these words of Jesus be alive in our heart and live a life worthy of his kingdom, practicing justice and righteousness. I'll close this in prayer. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this day, for the worship, for your words. Your words are alive in us this morning, Lord, as they are alive in the children that we serve in Ethiopia. You are a great God. You are a loving God, and our heart is today filled with your love. We thank you, merciful God, and we pray, Lord Jesus, you guide us to love mercy and love others that need our love in a hurting world. Father, we pray this morning that we become the salt and the light, that we become your disciples doing your work. Father, we thank you for this morning and for everything that has happened. And thank you for this country of America. And thank you for the people that have, Lord, generously helped many countries all over the world, that have welcomed many strangers to this nation, that have helped from people who are poor and needy, that have prayed for many nations over the years, have sent missionaries and supported missionaries all over the world. Father, I thank you for this country and for what it stands. Bless this country, Lord Jesus. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.